لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد عليه الصلاة والسلام وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد. We start by praising Allah. All praise belongs to Allah. We praise Him and seek forgiveness from Him and seek help from Him. Seek help from Him and we seek refuge with Him from the evil of ourselves and our souls and the sins of our deeds. Whomever Allah guides, no one can misguide. Whomever Allah misguides, no one can guide him. I testify that there is no true God except Allah alone, who has no partner, and that there is no one who is worthy of following except Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Dear brothers and sisters, today we continue as our brother Shafiq said, our journey through some points of our belief. And of course, the most important point of the aqidah of a Muslim is to the belief in Allah. The belief in Allah. And in order for us to know Allah, we can't know Him except through what He said. Because we can't see Him. And we can't know anything comparable to Him. As He said in His book, there is nothing like Him, and there is no one comparable to Him. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. And also He said, وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. And He also said, هَلْ تَعْلَمُ لَهُ سَمِيَّةٍ. All of this points to the fact that there is no way for us to know Allah except when He tells us, either in the Quran or in the Sunnah. And there is no way for us to understand the Quran or the Sunnah except through the way of those who accompanied the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah chose them to accompany His best messenger and prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And they taught all the ulama the same way as they preserved the Quran for us and they preserved the Sunnah for us. Those great people radiallahu anhum, they preserved the understanding of the Quran and the Sunnah for us. So the same way as we accept them to be the ones who bring us the Quran and the Sunnah, we must accept them also and their understanding in every aspect of Islam. That is why when we talk about Allah, which is, like I said, the most important article of our faith and belief, we must do so with adab. We must do so with utmost care and to be very careful of what we say, so that we don't say anything about Allah which He didn't say, or we don't say about Allah anything the Prophet ﷺ didn't say. Also, we must bear in mind that when we talk about Allah, we must have the knowledge of Arabic. So anyone who doesn't know Arabic will find it hard to understand certain things, just like if we were to speak to someone who doesn't speak English in English, they would find it hard, if not impossible, to understand it. For that reason, all of this I'm saying because the muqaddimah or muqaddama, both are correct, the introduction is very important, because everything that I'm going to say, we have to understand in that light, in the light of what Allah said, what the Prophet ﷺ said, and how the Sahaba and the Salaf, the pious predecessors, understood it, and how the ulama of this ummah understood it and taught us, so that we don't come up with ideas that contradict the Quran and the Sunnah, or they are understood not how the ulama of this nation of Islam understood, those great ulama who carried this deen all the way to us, and they still carry this deen into the future, and they will do so. So in the issue of what we call as-sifat especially, when we had the very first session, I mentioned that the issue of one tawheed, or one aspect of tawheed, and that is asma or sifat, which is the names and attributes of Allah. Not many Muslims differed that Allah is our Lord. In fact, not many people who bear relation to any religion, most Christians, people who follow Judaism, even Hindus, Sikhs and others, they do not argue with the fact that Allah is our Lord. There has been some difference between the Muslims and others in the issue of Tawheed al-Uluhiyya or Ibadah, in the issue who we must worship, because even though many people say that Allah is the only Lord and He is the one who created everything and owns everything, some people worship others with Him. As for the Muslims, then the greatest difference occurred in the issue of not even asma, not the names of Allah so much, even though some difference has occurred in that, but mostly it was in the issue of sifat. And that is how Allah described Himself. And the reason for that is because they did not follow the way of the Salaf. Those people who deviated from the path of the correct understanding of the Quran and the Sunnah, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about Himself and described Himself in the Quran and the Sunnah, if they were to follow the way of the Salaf, and by the Salaf I mean starting, like I said, from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, and all the way to the 300 years at the end of three centuries, that includes the four Imams. And tonight's topic is one part of the issue of Sifat, the attributes of Allah or the descriptions of Allah. Where is Allah? Because in order for us to worship Allah correctly, we must know Him. We must know Him through what He said. And He told us the issue of where He is. And I will show some Muslims, they don't allow people to ask, where is Allah? And I will explore that issue, inshallah, from the book and the Sunnah. And I will give some quotes of some of the Salaf, because it's impossible to give all the quotes, and I will refer you to some good books, inshallah. Before we go any further, there are three main misconceptions I would like to address, because it is better if they are addressed before the lecture rather than at the end of it or at the beginning of the lecture. And that is because every time we talk about where Allah is or where is Allah, these three occur. And the ulama, the scholars, they mention them in their books. The two books that I used mostly for my lecture are the very similar books, but they are slightly different. One of them is by Imam Ibn al-Qayyim, rahmahullah. As you know, a very, very great student of Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, rahmahullah, Shaykh al-Islam. And that is called Ijtima' al-Juyush al-Islamiyya ala ghazw al-Mu'attilati wal-Jahmiyya. The reason it's called that is because the title translates as the gathering of the Muslim armies for the fighting of Mu'attila, those who negate the attributes of Allah, or some of them. And Jahmiyyah is a group of those Mu'attila. Jahmiyyah, one of the worst groups. And the reason he called it that is because he gave proofs from the Quran and the Sunnah and the ulama, starting from the time of the Salaf, from the Tabi'een, and going all the way to his time, from all so-called madhabs and what people attribute themselves to, and from the four imams including. And the other book is by his contemporary and his friend, and considered to be one of his students, as well as the students of Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, because they used to learn from each other, not to feel shy. And that is Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah. And that book is called Al-Ulu lil-Ali al-Ghaffar. Al-Ulu means being the most high, establishing the fact that Allah is the most high, for the Al-Ali, the most high, Al-Ghaffar, the most forgiving. This book has been abridged by Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah, made smaller and corrected some of the ahadith. And those are the two books I used, and I'm not sure if they're available in English, because I only used the Arabic versions. So before I go any further, I would like to address those three, we call them in Arabic Shubha, Thalath Shubuhat, three doubts or some difficult issues that people raise when we talk about that. The first issue is Tashbih or Tamthil. Because when we say Allah is above the throne, as he said in the Quran, or he is above the heavens, as he said also in the Quran and the Sunnah, some people say if you say that, you compare Allah to his creation. And of course, it is very easy to answer that, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ, there is nothing like him. And in the same ayah he said, وَهُ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ, and he is the all-seer, all-hearer, or all-hearer, all-seer. And he himself called himself Sami', and he established the attribute of Sam', which is hearing, and Basar, which is seeing. And at the same time, he said, there is nothing like him. That clearly shows that we also can hear the same as Allah, but our hearing is not, of course, the same as Allah's hearing. The same way as our sight is not the same as the sight of Allah. And as we know, the ayah which says, وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ, there is nothing that is equivalent or equal to him. And this applies to all things, starting from the existence of Allah. I think in the first class, as far as I remember, I told you that when we talk about any sifa, or we talk to anyone who denies and says, if we say this attribute, it will become tamthil or tashbih, meaning comparing it to the people or to the creation, we say a very simple question. Do you believe Allah exists? If he says no, then he's a kafir. We don't need to discuss anything. He needs to become a Muslim. And of course, he has to say, yes, Allah exists. And we say, do I exist? If he says no, then he needs to seek help. Because if I'm in front of him and he says, you don't exist, that's something wrong. So he has to say, yes, you exist. So we say, is my existence like existence of Allah? He has to say no, because if he says yes, he's a kafir. Because to compare Allah to the creation is kufr akbar. For that reason we say, since you established Allah exists and I exist, and my existence is not like the existence of Allah, the ulama say, al-kalamu fi sifat kal kalami fi dhat, talking about Allah's creation, Allah's attributes, it's like talking about Allah himself subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we say, for example, do you believe Allah can see and hear? They say yes. Do you believe I can see and hear? Yes, and so on and so forth. So if we say Allah is above the throne, that doesn't mean that we compare Allah to the creation. And also there is ijma' of the salaf. All the Salaf. When we say Salaf, ikhwan, we don't mean just Joe Public in the street. We mean the ulama. the ulama who, not like even now, they used to spend all their time studying and spreading the deen. Some of their classes used to be attended by 70, 80,000 people. So they used to teach this aqidah, they used to teach this which they took from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. They agree, there is consensus, there is not single letter in which they said otherwise, other than to say what Allah said about himself and the Prophet ﷺ, without doing four things like we said in the first lecture. بِغَيْرِ تَكْيِيف, without saying how. Because if Allah didn't tell us how, we can't say how. Without doing tamthil, without comparing it to the creation. Without doing tahrif, which is changing either the meaning or the wording. Or without doing ta'til, which is negating. So this is ijma' of the Salaf. And I will give you a couple of quick quotes. Nu'aym bin Hammad al-Hafidh, one of the ulama of the Salaf, said, rahimahullah, من شبه الله بخلقه فقد كفر. Whoever compares to Allah, to his creation, has disbelieved. ومن أنكر ما وصف الله به نفسه فقد كفر. Whoever denies what Allah described himself with, he has disbelieved. وليس ما وصف الله به نفسه ولا رسوله عليه الصلاة والسلام تشبيها. And what Allah described himself and the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam is not tashbih, is not resembling Allah and likening him to his creation. Another great imam of the Salaf rahimahumullah said, Ishaq bin Rahawai, he said, innama yakunu tashbihu idha qal. The tashbih only happens, he said, when someone says, yadun mithlu yadi. Allah has a hand like my hand. But we don't say that. He's explaining who falls into tashbih or tamthil. أو سمع كسمعي. Hearing like my hearing. فهذا تشبيه. Then this is likening Allah to his creation. وأما إذا قال كما قال الله يد وسمع وبصر فلا يقول كيف ولا يقول مثل فهذا لا يكون تشبيها. But if he says, as Allah said, hand, hearing, sight, but doesn't say how, or doesn't say like, then that is not tashbih. قال تعالى ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير. Then he recited the ayah. Allah said, there is nothing like him, and he is the all-hearer, the all-seer. So this is the first issue that people, when we say Allah is above the throne, or he's above the heavens, they say, you have likened Allah to the creation. So this is very easy to answer. But only those whom Allah gives nur, the light of guidance, understand it. The second shubha, ash-shubhatu thaniya, kalimatu aw mas'alatu al-jiha. Jiha in Arabic means direction. So some people say, if you say Allah is above the throne, or he is above the heavens, you say you limit Allah to a direction. Then the ulama said, لم يرد لفظ الجهة في شيء من النصوص. The word jiha itself, it doesn't exist in the Quran or the Sunnah. That is why we say to a person who says, we can't say about Allah direction, or we can, we don't agree straight away or disagree. We say, what do you mean by that? What do you mean by direction, by jiha? If you mean that Allah is within some of his creation, then that is batil. That is not true, and that is cannot be said about Allah. So if the person means that someone means by saying jiha, direction, that Allah is within or some creation limits him, then of course that is batil. We can't say that about Allah. And if the person means what is beyond the creation, then Allah is above the creation. And also the ulama said, if the person wants to say that we can't say by that Allah is above the throne, then that is batil. We have to say as Allah said. Naam. But if they mean that nothing limits Allah and Allah is above everything, like he said in the Quran and the Sunnah, then we agree. So if someone brings a word that doesn't exist in the Quran or the Sunnah, and the Quran and the Sunnah didn't explicitly deny that word, we say, what do you mean by that? And this brings us to the third doubtful matter which people mention, and that is a place or makan in Arabic. They say, if you say Allah is above the throne, you limit him again to a place. We say, what do you mean? Because the word makan, we don't have in the Quran or the Sunnah. So we must try and avoid these words. Because if Allah didn't say something, we shouldn't describe Allah how he didn't describe himself. But if someone comes and says, we say, what do you mean by that? And the same answer that preceded in relation to direction applies, i.e., if you mean that Allah is limited by his creation or he's within his creation, that is batil. If you mean that Allah is above the throne and above his creation, then that is haqq, and we acknowledge that. But the advice of the ulama, we must avoid those words that the Prophet ﷺ didn't say and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say about himself. For example, I think I told you maybe this because I say it in many lectures. I had a discussion with a person on the train because I saw he's a Muslim, he saw I'm a Muslim. So we started talking and he said, we should unite. I said, I agree. But I said, on what basis do we unite? Do we unite on currency like the European Union? Or do we unite on some other basis? What is our basis that we unite? Our basis is very clear. Allah said in the Quran, hold on to the rope of Allah and don't be disunited. He said, that's correct. I said, then what does it mean that we must correct all of us our understanding of Islam? And whose understanding is better than that of the Prophet ﷺ and his Sahaba radiallahu anhu? There is no such thing, because even the non-Muslims, they say the best people who understand the way of Isa are the disciples. The best people who understand the way of Musa are his students. We say the same thing. And I don't think there are two Muslims that disagree on that. What they disagree is in the application of that. So I said to him, for example, where is Allah? He said, you must be a Salafi. I said, what do you mean by that? Because if I say yes, maybe he has some weird idea of a Salafi. And so I said, if you mean that we follow the Quran and the Sunnah, how the Sahaba and the Salaf understood, including the four Imams, because he claims to be Hanafi. So I want to say it to him. Including the four Imams, we teach Aqidah Tahawiyah, the Aqidah of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. In Saudi it's taught, they don't tell you maybe. In schools it's taught, Aqidah Tahawiyah. That's religious tolerance, madhab tolerance. I would like to see that in Pakistan and India. I don't think so. You'll be killed if you teach some other Aqidah, in my view. Yani they nearly kill you for the finger, forget the Aqidah. Okay, and if you say Ameen, that's it. One brother said some person heard in India or Pakistan and he said, which dog said Ameen? He stopped Salah, Ikhwan. The Imam, Allah Akbar, Alhamdulillah, Dalin, Ameen. Which dog said? Yani, what is this? Why, how can we unite if you call Muslims dogs? Because he follows what he believes is Sunnah from the Prophet Sallallahu. So those who accuse us of manners should look at their manners. So I said to him, where is Allah? He said, you must be Salafi. Anyway, we moved on and he said, where is he then? I said, even though I asked you first, but I will answer you. I said, he is above, and he knows my answer. He's above the throne, above the heavens. He said, is he sitting on it? I said, we don't say that because Allah didn't say about that about himself. If Allah said he is sitting, we would have said it. But he didn't say that. So the adab before we come to people with Allah is to not say what he didn't say. So I said, Akhil Karim, let us now go back to Tawheed. Do we all teach Tawheed? He said, yes, we teach Tawheed. I said, where? Which book do you teach from Tawheed? Doesn't matter if you teach Kitab al-Tawheed or you teach from Quran and Sunnah. The main thing, you teach Tawheed. He said, come, you will know. I said, I don't need to come. Just tell me, why do I need to come to know? It's like those who you say, how much does it cost to install internet? Say, you call us, we tell you. Just tell me now. I don't need to call you. Because if I call, you're going to waste my time 20 minutes just to tell me the price. Just tell me now. Don't waste my time. So he said, come and you will know. I know that for a fact they don't teach Tawheed. How can Ikhwan we unite when one of us says Allah is everywhere, one says Allah is above the throne, one says Allah is not inside the world, not outside, not to the left, right, left, above, down. Where is he? Because what they describe is non-existence. If you said, how do you describe non-existence? That is the best description. What doesn't exist inside the world or outside. Not to the right, not to the left. Not above, not down. Not behind me, not in front. That's non-existence. So how can we unite like that? How can Allah help us like that? So when we talk about Makan and everything else, and everything that we Allah didn't say, we have to have Naam. That's why when the Salaf talk about Makan, place, they mean what is beyond the creation, above the creation, from being the most high for Allah, because they want to refute the Jahmiyyah, the followers of Jahm bin Safwan, a big innovator who innovated many things. One of them is what I just said. Allah is not there and not there and not here and not there. And the Mu'attila, those who negate. And of course, the Salaf, they refuted that saying tremendously. Tremendously and very strongly. And after them, the person who refuted without any argument for a fair person is Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah. And he explained it very well in his fatwa, in his verdicts, in his fatwa, in his books that he wrote, and they were spread. Now, let us now look at some of the dalil, some of the adilla from the Quran al-Karim, from the Quran, that Allah is above, first of all, the heavens, and also above the throne, and above all the creation. Because if we are Muslims, we must abide by the Quran and Sunnah, not by our desires. That is the strength of the Muslim. The strength of the Muslim is not in his muscles only. Before that, the strength of the Muslim is in him following what Allah said. Because Allah then helps. Allah said, "In tansurullah yansurkum wa yuthabbit aqdamakum." If you help Allah, He will help you and establish firmly your feet. That means that to help Allah means, the ulama said, by establishing his deen, by believing what he said, by doing what he said. So that is the nasr of the deen. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said to Ibn Abbas, احفظ الله يحفظك. Protect Allah, He will protect you. How do you protect? Allah doesn't need anyone's protection. Meaning, protect the deen of Allah. So if we say we respect Allah, we must listen to the Quran. Otherwise, if our fathers say to us, look, I told you to buy water and you buy juice, you say, actually, you meant juice. Say, no, I meant water. He said, buy water. He said, no, no, you don't know yourself. He would say, Alhamdulillah, get lost. What did I don't know? Which father would accept from you? Which mother? You say to your mother, you didn't say to buy bread. You said to buy tissues. She said, no, I said bread to you. I wrote it even. No, you didn't mean bread. You meant tissues. That's what people tell us. They say, Allah didn't mean this. And who appointed you a translator? Who? Because we have people who are greater, greater than all of us. Number one, the Prophet ﷺ, who doesn't speak what he wants. He only speaks what Allah tells him. The Sahaba radiallahu anhu, who in 30 plus places in the Quran, Allah did tazkiyah of them. They don't need anyone's tazkiyah after that. That's why in ilm al-hadith, in the science of hadith, if you don't know the name of a sahabi, it doesn't matter. If it is a sahabi, that is okay, because they don't need anyone's tazkiyah, anyone's recommendation. Allah did it. So if we say that we truly follow the Prophet ﷺ, we must also follow his sahaba. Otherwise, we are liars. We don't really mean it. And if we say we truly believe Allah and believe that his book is true and his speech, we must accept what he says about himself. Otherwise, we are liars. We don't believe it really. So what did Allah say about himself? Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arsh istawa. Ar-Rahman has risen over the throne. Because the word istiwa doesn't mean like some people say istila in Arabic. Because istila means overpowering. Meaning Allah overpowered the throne. That's why I say, who made you a translator of the Quran? Especially when it's wrong translation. Because overpowering means, the ulama said, Allah and the throne wrestled. Where is the adab with Allah? You say, we compare Allah to the creation, those who criticize us, and you say Allah wrestled with the throne. Who says that in his right mind? Meaning there was a possibility for the throne to overpower. Who says that? Which Muslim says that? So istawa doesn't mean in Arabic istawla. And they don't have, of course, any proof for that except some poetry they give, which is not even found in books of poetry. Allah alam where it came from. So for that reason, we understand the Quran as Allah said. Ar-Rahman al-Arsh istawa. In seven places Allah talked about him rising over the throne, because the ulama said ista'la wartafa', that he rose over. Doesn't mean he wrestled, he overpowered. Doesn't mean that. And some people lie about Ibn Taymiyyah rahmullah, and they say when he said it, Allah coming down, he said, just like I'm coming down the minbar, that's how Allah comes down. He never said that. Hey, Ikhwan, we have to think better of the Muslims, let alone the ulama, let alone the best ulama. If I know it and I'm miskin, how can we accuse, except if we hate the man, and Allah said, don't, even if you hate, don't speak what is not true about people. People hate Ibn Taymiyyah. That's why I said to some brothers, if you want to check which masjid you're in, just walk in and say, Ibn Taymiyyah, and see what happens. But you should wear a helmet and protective gear. Because you may need it. Because people, by the looks, you will know what's going on. And if some say, MashaAllah, that's alhamdulillah, okay. Because the man, just analyze what I said about Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab rahmullah in one of the lectures. Just analyze. Anyone you want to know, analyze their lives, what they say and believe and did, said. And he himself said to the people who opposed him rahmullah, anything I write, please show me where I made the mistake. Mistake means what? Not how I think or you think. If what contradicts the what Allah said, the Prophet ﷺ said, and the Sahaba agreed and the Salaf agreed. He even didn't say agreed. He said, anything I contradicted the Salaf in any issue of Aqidah, of belief. What's more important, which hand to use for eating or which Allah, which God to worship? And many jama'at, they say we do da'wah. They never teach people Tawheed. And if you talk about it, they say, you are making difference and you splitting the people. Are we really supposed, Allah said, collect everyone even if they worship Lat and Uzza? Even if they worship dead people in the grave. MashaAllah, come brother, MashaAllah, brother, MashaAllah. Who said that? No one except someone who wants something behind the gatherings. Allah didn't say that. The Prophet's own uncles, some of them didn't believe. The Quran is called, one of the names of the Quran is Al-Furqan, criterion, makes farq, distinction between people who follow the haqq and people who follow the batil. Our job, ikhwan, there is no letter in the Quran or Sunnah that says, unite the Muslims, doesn't matter what they believe, unite. That is bid'ah, that is innovation. So Allah said, unite upon the Quran and Sunnah in the understanding of the Sahaba. That's it. So if you don't want to talk about Tawheed, then we have other people, even non-Muslims talk about etiquette of eating. MashaAllah. Take the fork this way and the spoon this way. What's this? We can learn it, no problem. Internet even, you can learn how to eat. But how to worship Allah we need. We need how to worship Allah, not how to eat only. How to eat, inshallah, we'll teach. After we teach how to worship Allah. Who you worship? Wallahi, ikhwan, one brother said to me, and he said, I went with some brothers, and they told me Allah is everywhere. So he said, I was teaching him Arabic. He said to me, tell me, is Allah everywhere? Because he said, I make dua everywhere. He said, Allah help me. Wallahi, I'm not lying, ikhwan. Oh Allah, he was looking at the floor. Then he said, subhanAllah, this is stupid, he said. How can I look at the floor and say Allah? I said, that's true, because the fitrah, even the non-Muslims, they say the man upstairs. And they know that Allah is not everywhere, ikhwan. That is one of the beliefs of Jahmiyyah. That's why the ulama of the Salaf, they refuted them. And I will show you what also Abu Hanifa rahimahullah said, who some people claim to be following. Claim, and whenever there is a discussion, say, I'm Hanafi, stop. Say, no problem. You Hanafi? In what? In what are you Hanafi? Let's analyze. In fiqh? It's rubbish. Where is in fiqh you Hanafi? You don't even know what Abu Hanifa said. Which Hanafi are you? Which Hanafi? Where is the book of Abu Hanifa you read? Or the fatawa of Abu Hanifa? Where are they? In your house? There? Where? Show me. So don't lie about Imam, that great Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. In Aqidah, forget it. What Aqidah of Abu Hanifa? They don't even know. Aqidah Tahawiyah, they learn for barakah. Like Bukhari. They say, we learn Bukhari. Bukhari says, don't do bid'ah. They say, we learn Riyadus Salihin. Riyadus Salihin, one of the chapters, not to do bid'ah. Where is it? When we learn, it doesn't mean like this. So when Allah says Ar-Rahman Arash Istawa, we can't say any other thing. If we are true, because we all want for every Muslim to follow that, because ikhwan, we don't want to be humiliated like I said today in the khutbah. The Prophet said Allah will remove the humiliation when you go back to the deen. That is the deen. But when someone believes Allah is everywhere, someone believes Allah is not there. Alaykum salam wa rahmatullah. And someone believes Allah is on the throne. How is Allah going to help us? Some say, don't talk about Allah like this. Allah overpowered the throne. How is he going to help us? How is he going to remove the humiliation from us? Also Allah said to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, Inni rafi'uka ilay. I will raise you to me. I will raise you to me. Also he said, بَرَّفَعَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ. After he refuted the claim of those who say they crucified Isa عليه الصلاة. He said, but Allah, rather Allah raised him to himself. Also Allah said about the angels, يَخَافُونَ رَبَّهُمْ مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ. They fear their Lord from above them, in the Quran. Also Allah said in Surah Al-Mulk, أَأَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ أَنْ يَخْسِفَ بِكُمُ الْأَرْضِ فَإِذَا هِيَ تَمُورِ. Do you fear or do you feel safe that the one above the heavens? Because when we say فِي السَّمَاءِ doesn't mean within the heavens, as I will now explain when we go to the ahadith. Because when we say, what's going on in the world, do we mean inside the earth? Who says, who thinks like that? What's going on in this country, meaning underground? Who says that? Who understands like that? No one. So when we say, fis sama, meaning ala sama, fawqa sama, above the heavens. Also Allah said, إليه يصعد الكلم الطيب والعمل الصالح يرفعه. To him ascends the good, ascend the good words, the good speech. And good deeds raise it. Raise. Also Allah spoke a lot and a lot in the Quran about the Quran being tanzil, coming down. We call it revelation, but in Arabic actually it's tanzil. Tanzil means sending down. Down. Also Allah said, تَعْرُجُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالْرُوحُ إِلَيْهِ. تَعْرُجُ, the word mi'raj comes from that. Ascend, the malaika ascend to him. And Jibril ascends to him. We also of course say, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. Al-A'la means the most high. And we say in our sujood, at least should say, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Subhan means Allah is free from any defect and imperfection. Rabbi, my Lord, al-A'la, the most high. Let us look at some of the adilla from the sunnah. There are more from the Quran. But let's look from the sunnah. The hadith of Muawiyah ibn al-Hakam al-Sulami, radiallahu anhu, in Sahih Muslim. It's a long hadith. It says that Muawiyah ibn al-Hakam al-Sulami was new Muslim. He came to pray with the Prophet ﷺ. So while in Salah, he sneezed. And he said something, Alhamdulillah, or something. He spoke in Salah. So people started looking at him. He said to them, why are you looking at me? And he's in Salah. He said, don't look at me. So they turned away. In Salah, inside the prayer. Then when they finished, the Prophet ﷺ said, who spoke? He said, me. So he said, this is how Muawiyah describes, he said, and how good a teacher the Prophet ﷺ was, he said. That's new Muslim. He said, he never hit me. He never spoke rude to me. He just said, this is Salah. You shouldn't speak in Salah. In Salah, we do tasbih, tahmid, what Allah said, we read Quran. And we do dhikr, that's in Salah. Then the ulama say he felt brave to ask because he saw how the Prophet treats him nicely. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I have a slave girl. And I left her with my sheep. And one day the wolf came and ate one of the sheep or took one of the sheep. So I'm a human being, he said. I got angry and I slapped her. So he said, the Prophet ﷺ started reprimanding me and he made it a big deal, he said. فَعَظَّمَ عَلَيَّ. He made it a big deal, I felt bad, he said. So that I said, should I set her free? The Prophet ﷺ said, bring her. Because if I don't mention this hadith, then the topic of the talk might go. Because that's where it's taken from. So the Prophet ﷺ said to this slave girl, where is Allah? She said, "Fi sama," which means in Arabic, literally, in the heavens, but it means above the heavens. I will show you now why. He said, who am I? She said, "Anta Rasulullah." You are the messenger of Allah. So the Prophet said, "A'tiqha fa innaha mu'mina." Make her free because she's a believer. Ikhwan, you know, this hadith is great. Not only in the fact that you're allowed to ask where is Allah, because many people say you can't ask where is Allah. The Prophet ﷺ asked. Another thing is that how Islam encourages to help people who are slaves in need. And you know, slavery issue is a big issue itself in Islam. We can talk about it, inshallah, in separate gathering. But how Islam, just he slept, and his slave before, sleeping is like a part of being a slave, part of the CV. You know, that man just slept her. The Prophet kept telling him that it's bad, it's not Allah, what did you do, until he felt bad. And he said, should I just free her for Allah? And the Prophet said to free her. So that's how Islam treats people. That is the true Islam. That is not Islam in the TV. That is not Islam in the newspapers. This is true Islam. So that is hadith. This hadith narrated in Sahih Muslim. So that no one can say, oh, you got it from somewhere. This is Sahih Muslim. This is authentic hadith. Hadith Jabir radiallahu anhu in Bukhari and in, I believe, in Muslim, when he did his famous khutbah on the day of Arafah in his Hajj, because he only did Hajj once, alayhi sallam, in the 10th of Hijrah. That's why it's called Hajjatul Wada', the farewell Hajj, because after that he didn't do any other Hajj. That was the last and the first and the last Hajj. He never did any other Hajj. And in it, he, alayhi sallam, said on the day of Arafah, Allahumma shahad. It's a long hadith as well, but I'm just taking the what we need. Allahumma shahad, because he asked the people, there were over 100,000 there. He said, do you testify? I have delivered the message Allah said to me to deliver. They said, yes. And he said, pointing with his finger, this is for those who say you can't point, pointing with his finger to the heavens and saying, oh Allah, bear witness. Bear witness, and he said three times, Allahumma ashhad, Allahumma ashhad, Allahumma ashhad. Another hadith of Abu Huraira regarding the angels of the night and the angels of the day, because the Prophet said there are angels of the night who come and stay with you during the night, and there are angels of the day that come and stay with you during the day. They assemble during Fajr and Asr. That's why it's very great to pray those two prayers, and especially if you can in Jama'ah, in a congregation. And of course, in it the Prophet said, ثُمَّ يَعْرُجُ إِلَيْهِ الَّذِينَ بَاتُوا فِيكُمْ. Those that spent the night with you, they ascend to Allah. Another hadith, which is Abdullah bin Amr bin Al-As, الرَّاحِمُونَ يَرْحَمُهُمُ الرَّحْمَانِ. The Prophet said, those who have rahmah to others, Allah ar-Rahman, the one who has the most rahmah, will show them rahmah. Even if we have, as you know, rahmah, mercy to animals for the sake of Allah. Then he said, irhamu man fil ard, yarhamkum man fil sama. Have rahmah for those who are upon the earth. This is the hadith that explains what is meant by fis sama. The one above the heavens will have rahmah on you. Because it says, fil ard, have mercy on those who are, if you literally translate, in the ground. Meaning what, the worms? No, it means above the ground, those who walk the earth. The people, the animals, the trees, everything. This is before the RSPCA. So that you know that Islam teaches, because many people say, you know, they make the Muslim feel bad, that as if Islam is terrorism and stuff. You know, you have to know you have a great religion that many hundreds of years ago told us to have rahmah on everyone, because Allah didn't, the Prophet didn't say have rahmah just on people. He said have rahmah for everything of everyone upon the earth. The one upon the heaven will have mercy on you. And this is narrated by Abu Dawud Tirmidhi and authenticated by Tirmidhi and others, rahimahumullah. Hadith Anas, that Zainab bint Jahsh, radiallahu anha, one of the wives of the Prophet ﷺ, used to say to the other wives, because even though they didn't used to do dhulm to other wives, except very rarely, still there is competition between wives. So she used to say, because she has to find something with which to find that she's better than them. Like Aisha, she used to say to the Prophet ﷺ regarding her being the only one virgin. So Zainab bint Jahsh used to say to the wives, "Zawwajakunna ahalikunna." Your people, your families married you to the Prophet ﷺ. But me, I was married by the one above the seven heavens. Because Allah revealed ayat to Mary, allowing the Prophet to marry Zainab bint Jahsh. And that we married you. Zawwajnakaha. So, and in another narration she said, Allah married me, the one above the heavens. And in another narration, she used to say to the Prophet ﷺ, Ar-Rahman, who is above the throne, married me to you. And this hadith is in Bukhari, and some of the versions are in other books. Now, another hadith is the hadith of Abu Hurairah, that the Prophet ﷺ said, "Man tasaddaqa bi'adli tamratin min kasbin tayyib," whoever gives sadaqah equal to one date, just one date, one tamra, from good earnings, halal earnings, وَلَا يَسْعَدُ إِلَى اللَّهِ إِلَّا الطَّيِّبِ. Only halal ascends to Allah. Now, and this hadith is also in Bukhari. And of course I mentioned two more, because we don't have enough time. One is the hadith of Mi'raj. Mi'raj means the ascension. It's in Bukhari and Muslim, where the Prophet ﷺ was raised by his person. Because why do we say it? Because the Quraysh, those kuffar, the non-Muslims, the mushriks, if someone said, in a dream, I've been to Mars, you'll say, it's okay, we know in a dream you can be anywhere. Why did they refute that the Prophet ﷺ could in one night do Isra? Isra means night travel. What Allah said in Surah Al-Isra, that he took him from the Masjid Al-Haram to the Masjid Al-Aqsa in Jerusalem in one night. That time it was impossible. Then the same night Mi'raj took him up to above the seventh heavens, and that of course shows that Allah is above the seventh heaven. And finally the hadith of Nuzul, Allah, in the Bukhari and Muslim as well. And this also how people have an issue with it. I mean, if you're really Muslim, ikhwan, how can you have an issue with what the Prophet said? Tell me that. I don't understand. Since I started practicing Islam, because I was born a Muslim, since I started practicing, when people say, no, the Prophet didn't mean it, who made you translator for him? Who? How can you say you are a Muslim and you reject what the Prophet said? So the Prophet ﷺ said, when the last third, and most Muslims know this hadith, when the last third of the night remains, Allah comes down to the lowest heaven. The last third. How do you calculate the last third? You look at the Maghrib time. Let's say now 6 o'clock. You look at Fajr time beginning. Let's say it's 5 o'clock. So 6 till 5, whatever many hours, you divide it into three parts. Then you remove two-thirds, and that last third is what's left. That's the last third. So you look at Maghrib, you look at Fajr, Fajr time, beginning, not the Jama'ah, the beginning. Then you divide it into three, then you add two. For example, if it's 12 hours, you divide into three, you get four. You double it by two, you get 8 hours. You add 6 o'clock, 8 hours, 2 a.m., it starts. And Allah says, who is seeking forgiveness from me so I can forgive him? Who is asking me so I can give him? Every night. So when we say that, some people say, does it mean Allah leaves the throne? Ikhwan, can't we have some adab with Allah? Allah never stops being Al-A'la. Never. The reason they ask is because they think Allah is like us. That's the secret. That is the secret. When Allah says both of his hands are right, they say, how is it possible? Yahi, Allah said Allah is not like you. Allah is not like you. Don't compare him to you. You say we compare. We don't compare. You say, how is Allah coming down and he leaves the throne? We didn't say that. Allah didn't say that. You thought it because you compare Allah to us. That is what the ulama said. They run away from what they run away. They fall into worse things. They say we run away from comparing Allah to the creation. And they fall into worse. Who says that if Allah comes down, he leaves the throne? Did Allah say that? No. Did the Prophet ﷺ say it? No. We say both we believe. If someone says, how is it possible? We say, if you believe, it's possible. And it's not against logic. Some people say, that's not logically possible. It's possible. We can give examples of the moon, the ulama said, which is always with us, and we're moving. And the moon is moving. That's just creation of Allah. How about Allah? And to understand that, we must know Allah. There is a hadith that says, the Prophet said, it has been permitted to me to describe one angel from those that carry, and maybe I said it to you before, from those that carry the throne of Allah. He said, between his shoulder to his ear is the distance of 700 years by a fast bird. 700 years, Ikhwan. That is because people don't know Allah, they talk like this. That's the one carrying the throne. How about between the shoulder and the lower, like the legs and things? It's not impossible. It's not possible to imagine. Another hadith says, the heavens and the earth, look, the heavens and the earth, we are nothing compared to them. Compared to the kursi. The kursi, which translates as a chair. Some ulama say it's the footstool of Allah. Some ulama say that narration from Ibn Abbas is not authentic. So we call it kursi. The heavens and the earth, samawat wal ard, compared to the kursi, the Prophet said, is like a ring thrown into the desert. The kursi compared to the throne is the same. Who understands that, Ikhwan? Before you say how and this and what Allah and this, you have to try and understand the greatness of Allah. The greatness of Allah. For that reason, we must be very careful when we talk about the Quran and Sunnah. The hadith are very many, 96 in the book of Zahabi, and that's only the ones that Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah authenticated. And the book of Ibn al-Qayyim is close to that. The hadith alone. 96 hadith talking about Allah is above the heavens or above the throne. Now let me give you, because time is pressing us, some athar from the Salaf. And I don't mean, because the other athar from other Salaf are very well known. I chose three individuals, two from the Salaf, and third who follows those two, Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. Those who say, I'm Hanafi. Good, let's see. Abu Muti' al-Hakam bin Abdullah al-Balkhi. He was one of the great ulama and students of Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah. And he is the one who correctly is the fiqh al-akbar is attributed to, not Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah. He said, سألت أبا حنيفة عمن يقول لا أعرف ربي في السماء أو في الأرض.
I asked Abu Hanifa rahimahullah about a person who says, I don't know, my Lord is in the heavens or the earth, above the heavens or upon the earth. فَقَالَ قَدْ كَفَرْ. He said he's a kafir. لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يَقُولَ الرَّحْمَانُ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ اسْتَوَى. Because Allah says, الرَّحْمَان has risen over the throne. وَعَرْشُهُ فَوْقَ سَمَاوَاتِهِ. And his throne is above his heavens. فَقُلْتُ إِنَّهُ يَقُولُ. So this Imam said to Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, I said to him, he says, أَقُولُ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ اسْتَوَى. I say Allah rose over the throne, which most Hanafis don't say. I challenge them to say it. I say, الرحمن, he says, he rose over the throne, but he says, لَا يَدْرِي الْعَرْشُ فِي السَّمَاءِ أَوْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. He says, I don't know if the throne is above the heavens or on earth. He said, إِذَا أَنْكَرَ أَنَّهُ فِي السَّمَاءِ فَقَدْ كَفَرْ. If he refuses to accept the throne of Allah is above the throne, he has disbelieved. Why? Because it contradicts what Allah said, Ikhwan. It's a very dangerous thing. People play around like it's, you know, having lunch. It's not, it's very dangerous. It can take the person out of Islam easily. Also, Abu Hanifa rahimahullah said, and this is with authentic chains that you can see in the book of Ibn al-Qayyim and al-Dhahabi. Abu Hanifa rahimahullah said, من أنكر أن الله عز وجل في السماء فقد كفر. Who doesn't accept that Allah is above the heavens, he has disbelieved. He's a kafir. Let us look at Abu Yusuf rahimahullah. Most people know Abu Imam al-Qadi, al-Qadi, the judge Abu Yusuf rahimahullah. When Bishr al-Marisi, one of the innovators, who used to deny that Allah is above the throne, he appeared. Abu Yusuf rahimahullah was a judge, and he said he must be made to repent or he must be executed. Now, that's a very famous story which the person who explained Aqidah Tahawiyyah, Ibn Abil Izz al-Hanafi rahimahullah, he's Hanafi alim. He said this story is very well known, and he said a person who says Allah is everywhere is not following Abu Hanifa. So it's not a new problem. Also, Abu Ja'far al-Tahawi, who is a Hanafi alim from Egypt, he said in his Aqidah, Allahu, what's the meaning? Allahu muhitum bi kulli shay'in wa fawqahu. Allah encompasses everything and knows everything and sees everything, and He's above everything. He's not everywhere. And finally, people, when we sometimes speak to them and they say Allah is everywhere, they bring some ayat like "Uhu ma'akum aynama kuntum," that He's with you wherever you are. ما يكون من نجوى ثلاثة إلا هو رابعهم ولا خمسة إلا هو سادسهم. That there is no talk or conversation of three except he's the fourth, of five except he's the sixth, and so on. وهو الذي في السماء إلهنا في الأرض إله. These ayat, Ikhwan, either they show that Allah is worshipped in the heavens and the earth, like هو الذي في السماء إلهنا في الأرض إله. إله in Arabic means worshipped. Or they show that He is with us not by Himself, by His ilm, by His knowledge and everything. And some ulama even said, since Allah is so great and our world is tiny, He's close to us. Because we are nothing, we are midgets, we are nothings. And Allah's throne is double of that little ring in the whole desert. That's Allah's throne in relation to the Kursi. Even if you say that hadith is not authentic, how about that angel that carries Allah's throne? and he's so great. And how about Jibril, who has 600 wings, Ikhwan? 600 wings. The Prophet said, this is hadith in Bukhari, I couldn't see the horizon. I couldn't see the horizon because Jibril came in his real form. Doesn't it show how great Allah is? Doesn't it show what He created, His greatness? This heaven, all the heavens, all the earths, all the everything, the universe, all of this shows Allah is great. That's why we say, and most Muslims don't understand it, Allahu Akbar. When we pray, Allahu Akbar, means Allah is the greatest, A'zam. It means Allah is the greatest. For that reason, we must have adab with Allah. We must have adab with His book. We must have adab with Rasulullah alayhi salam. We must have adab with His sunnah. That is the real salvation. And we must have adab with His sahaba and with the ulama of Islam. Rahimahumullah. That is where I stop. And if you have any questions, you're very welcome to ask.